good morning and welcome to the Huston-Tillotson University Thursday Chapel Hour. You know what time it is. If you're with us today, we're going to pray that it's not your first time. If it is, we welcome you and want you to join us as we give God our praise with our chapel theme song. Grab a seat. Do your dance. It's Thursday. Oh, when you know what time it is, it's time for chapel. Join us. Lift your voices as we give God the praise. I'm blessed. I'm ready. I'm here to bless the Lord. I'm blessed. I'm ready. I'm here to bless the Lord. Come on in. Grab a seat and do your dance. It's Thursday. Oh, and you already know it's time for chapel. One more time here. Let's go, let's go, let's go. I'm blessed. The refrain. Grab a seat, do your dance. It's Thursday. And it's time for chapel. All right. Let's give God some praise. It's Thursday on the Huston-Tillotson University campus, and it's time for chapel. Amen.
This atmosphere, the Lord is my light and...
Amen. I'm going to ask if you would bow with me for a word of prayer. Eternal and gracious God, we come today and always in the spirit of thanksgiving. We thank you, gracious God, for your waking us this morning and allowing us to witness a brand new day. We thank you, gracious God, for our time in this place, in this space called the Huston-Tillotson University Chapel Hour. We thank you, dear God. We thank you for vaccines that are being distributed throughout this nation so that we can prayerfully begin to see an end to COVID-19. We ask, gracious God, that you would allow us to engage our activities with wisdom as we find our city and cities around this nation opening up fully in the midst of COVID-19. And fill us, gracious God, with your spirit. Fill us with your wisdom. We pray, gracious God, for those who continue to engage in final exams today and tomorrow. And then, dear God, as we broach a spring break beginning next week, actually Friday. We ask, gracious God, that as our students take time to rest, relax, and refresh themselves, that they would engage wisely during the spring break season. We ask, gracious God, that you would cover them in your blood, that you would protect them, and that you would guide them, and that you would allow them to come back safely and ready to finish out this academic year. We ask, gracious God, that you would be with us in this moment, that you would open our minds and our hearts, that we might receive what it is that you have for us on this day. Breathe on us, Holy Spirit. Move through us in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen, amen. And today we give God praise. And actually, wanted to introduce somebody special to you today. Want to start a little early here. Want to do somebody very special. And that's in the person, and I believe she's on your screen right now. And that's in the person of Miss Shakitha Stinson. How you doing, Shakitha?
Hello, how are you?
I'm doing wonderfully well. Are you having a good day so far?
I am.
Good.
It's always a good day when you're on this side of the earth.
Always. Yeah, certainly the better of the two alternatives, right?
Yes.
Can you move your screen down so we can see more of your face there? Just a little bit. You're looking so beautiful there. We want to be able to get all of you. There you go. Thank you. That's better. Mrs. Stinson, some of you have met Mrs. Stinson, if you share with us on a weekly basis. Ms. Stinson is a part of the HT family. She is part of our staff in the Department of Student Services. She's Director of Student Services for the Adult Degree Program. Is that right, Ms. Stinson?
That is correct.
Okay, but Ms. Stinson is going to surprise us today, and I'm going to switch from Ms. Stinson to Minister Stinson. because Minister Stinson is going to share with us the Word of God. And this is something new for us. So Minister Stinson, can you share with us how long you've been in ministry and something about your travels and your engagement as a minister?
Well, I have been in ministry since 2006. So that's quite a few years there. Came to ministry, you know, just grew up in church. So let me just start there. Grew up in church, just like a lot of us have. Was always a singer. I started singing with the adult choir at 5 years old. My grandmother put me there, and you know, leading songs. And so I thought that that's what I was supposed to do. I thought that's what God had for me. Not knowing and not understanding that my early preparation was just something to build for what he had for me ultimately, and that was to be in ministry. I grew up in a church where they didn't believe in women ministers. For years, I was in churches where they didn't believe in women ministers, and God sent a ministry for me. I used to live in Georgetown for a while, driving back and forth to HT, and I would notice this church building. Well, it wasn't really a church, but it was a church. I started hearing the minister, the pastor, on the radio. And I just decided to go and attend. I was married at that time, so we went and we attended. And again, God just knew what he knew what he had in store for me. And so he had to put me in a place where I could be nurtured as a minister so that I could fully grasp and accept that he was calling me to ministry. And I'm so grateful for my ministry now. I attend Church of the Living Water, where I am an associate minister there. I've been there for 23 years now, 23 years. And so God is just, he's just great. He's great. And I would just say that never underestimate what God has for you. Never underestimate what God, because whatever he has for you, it is for you.
All right.
And so that's my story.
All right. And he'll find you. Well, we are glad that you are here. We've had you as alumni. We've getting you now as preacher. I guess we have to get you back to sing for us too, with all the gifts and graces that God has blessed you with. But we're glad that you are here, and we look forward to hearing from you in just a bit. So praise God for you, and we're looking forward to seeing you back shortly. That's Miss Minister Shakitha Stinson. And I need to say up front, today we have all women, and for the month of March, this is National Women's History Month. So what we do on the Huston-Tillotson University campus, we seek to recognize women in National Women's History Month and to just have them in our chapel experience. And so this week and next week is spring break, but the following week we'll also have women who we will celebrate for National Women's History Month. And at this time, we're going to turn it over for Spice It Up with Miss Sonia Lathan. Take it away, Sonia.
Hello. Hello, everyone. So this is Spice, and we only have a few minutes, as you know, Brad said I have to be timely. And so I want to really jump into this. So if you don't have a pen and piece of paper, you need to grab one, because you will be jotting something down. And I'm going to place the instructions in the chat and as well as on Facebook for our viewers that are there as well. And so once you get your pen and piece of paper, I'm going to do this quick little exercise to kind of give you an idea of what the time frame is like. You only have a minute to do this. So if you would, I want you to close your eyes really quick, and I'm going to start the timer. When you feel as though that it's been 30 seconds, I want you to open your eyes, okay? No cheating, you know, just don't count. I just want you to close your eyes right now, and I'm going to start the timer, and when you think that the 30 seconds is up, then open your eyes. I'm starting now. As this time goes, just keep in mind, we are going to have a lot of fun with this, but just open your eyes when you think it's more than, when it's 30 seconds. just went off, so you guys did good. So now you have that idea of what that 30 seconds is like. So you have a minute right now. I'm going to put this in the chat. You have to write down as many one-word adjectives to describe what the word woman means to you. And you can start now. It is almost time. And 10.
As good as theirs, though.
Oh, okay, all right. Well, Rev, how many did you have? Because we have like less than a minute and a half. What's your top three?
Top three would be organizer, leader, queen.
All right, organizer, leader, and queen. And I thought this exercise would be great because we always want to know what people think. And a lot of times when you think of women, you think of moms, you think of organizers, you think of educators, you think of all those great things. But these are great adjectives to describe what women are. We are versatile, we are faithful, we are courageous, and we are unique in our own way, as well as enduring, because we can endure a lot, and as well as being resilient and strong and wise, being a leader, and most of all, what I really loved about Rev was being a queen. That queen is just a title that gives you something that no one else can take away. But that was my spice for today. I don't know if anyone played on Facebook, but this will be the end that you all see me. I'm going to go ahead and man the Facebook live chat and make sure that everybody's taken care of. But I hope you all enjoyed that. I hope you all take those things with you and remember the words of the other sisters and everyone that shared with this, because it is important to have those types of adjectives in our minds about ourselves. So thank you for participating. And you ladies have a great rest of your day. And Rev, I'm going to go ahead and get off and be on Facebook.
All right. Thank you, Miss Sonia. All right. For Spice Today. All right. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. All right. We want to introduce our guests for today. And they are two very special ladies. One was actually instrumental in helping me to get the nerves up to really follow through and do a virtual chapel experience. And the other we've shared oftentimes in prayer. We've had groups of folk who have met in the chapel during the lunch hour, and we engaged in prayer. So want to on this day welcome two very special women, and that's Miss Danielle McGhee and Miss Canary Gallion. Good afternoon, ladies. Or should I say good morning, Steele? How are you doing? Go ahead and unmute yourself, Miss Gallion. There you go, so we can hear you. How are you doing this morning?
How are you? Can you hear me?
There you go. Can hear you now. Yes. And so for both of you, glad that you are here. And since you are there, Miss Gallion, why don't you start by telling us just a little bit about yourself?
Okay, my name is Canary Gallion. I moved here from Mississippi, so of course I work at HT. I'm the director of Middle Three. I am a fundamental and spiritual person. I love what I do in the HPC community. That's a little bit about myself.
All right, how about it, Danielle McGhee? And I'm going to just go ahead and leave your mics unmute, because we're going to just talk to each other, all right? Yeah, all right. Talk to us, Miss Danielle McGhee.
Well, my name is Danielle McGhee, and I am from Round Rock, Texas, and I am the Director of Library and Media Services here at Huston-Tillotson, and I attended school, moved to D.C., attended Howard University undergrad at North Carolina Central for grad school, and so I'm a lover of HBCUs and what they offer students. I am a creative person. I have written a book titled Every Girl Poops, A Diary of Poems from a Girl Who Poops, for those of you who have a sense of humor, but it's a book of short poems, and I also am an artist. My website is DanielleSharella.com, and so I'm just a creative person. You know, I like to create photography, mix and mingle, hang out with my friends. I'm very social and just a lover of life.
Awesome. A question, and perhaps we'll alternate from time to time. What created in you the desire to become a librarian?
Well, initially, I didn't know that being a librarian was an actual profession that you could grow in. Okay. And so when I learned about it, it took me back to, as a child, growing up in Round Rock. I'm a lover of the Round Rock Public Library, and I always thought it was a creative, safe, fun, innovative place to learn. And just from the community aspect, that's something that I really remember as a child. And so when I learned about it as a profession, I thought about how I could merge that experience along with learning about history and preserving history. I would say points of interest that I have. And once I learned about it as a profession, that's something that I wanted to explore. And it's a longer story than that, but this is the Cliff Notes version.
Okay. Well, we appreciate the Cliff Notes for today, and we'll get back and we'll do a whole series and get the full scope. How about that? We do appreciate you, Miss Gallion, Canary. You are in Title III. Was that someplace you desired to be a director in that area? How did you get there? Okay.
I have a passion for federal policies and laws and procedures, and so that was kind of my interest. That was the same, pretty much the same task that I had at a former university. So moving here to Austin and working at HT put me in the same field I was in. So I enjoy writing, so that's part of my job, and learning about different federal policies and laws. I have a master's in public policy, so that was kind of my interest. Okay. So it kind of ties into what I do. So, yes.
Awesome. I love that. It even keys in to last week. We ended February, the first week of March, right? But we had to complete it because we had the snowstorm. But last week we had the two men who were on talked about following your passion. And hearing some of that as you talk about the fields that you find yourselves, that ultimately find your passion and then follow your passion. That's awesome. And today we hope that we're also hearing and speaking to our young ladies on the HT campus and beyond. A question for you, and I'm going to say whoever wants to take it. In this age of elevating women, black girl magic, black girls rock, what are your thoughts about Vice President of the United States, Vice President Kamala Harris? And I'm going to pull out Miss Stacey Abrams, running for Congress, and I believe that she was instrumental in turning Georgia blue. Talk about them just for a moment, and what do they mean to you, and perhaps for our country and for our young ladies. Whoever wants to take it can take it.
Sometimes you have those that, well, we're always trying to break the glass ceiling, you know, even for women. And people find, like, Shirley Chisholm. You know, she was like a star and a forerunner. You know, she ran for president. And then there were other black and African history, even beside her, although that they didn't make it to that point. But it's about, I just see, like, you know, this step. So somebody starting off, somebody sitting on somebody else's shoulder in order that we can rise to the top to break history. So I consider them as history makers. They're phenomenal women. They're out there, have a voice, and they're growing in this season. So I like what they're doing, even with their causes for community action, social justice, and those different things. So that's a way for them even to open the doorways for others to continue to break glass ceilings, because that's what we want to do. We want to break glass ceilings.
All right.
We want to make history. And we want to do great things. You know, even in government, we will have a voice. So I think what they have done and will do will be very instrumental.
Awesome. I'm glad you mentioned Shirley Chisholm. I think she is all too often forgotten. And indeed a trailblazer for even folk like Kamala Harris, right? And even that's back in the 60s, because I was a really small kid when she ran for president. Great. Do you want to respond to that, Danielle?
Yeah, I mean, just to piggy off of what Ms. Gallion mentioned, I definitely think that it's not easy to do what they're doing. And to be able to do the next best thing is commendable and definitely something inspiring and something to look up to in terms of breaking that glass ceiling. And there's a level of courage and strength and resilience that, you know, as we talked about all those adjectives earlier, you have to have all of those things to really make the changes that are happening in breaking those glass ceilings. So I know it's not easy, but it's definitely something that we're seeing that is possible.
Okay, so you said it's something that we're seeing and it's something that's possible. What will it take for our young black girls are young women to achieve a status of a Stacey Abrams or a Kamala Harris?
I think that being clear on one's purpose, what their goals are, and who they want to serve is important in moving in that direction. I think you can't just do something like that and to not have that clarity. So I think having that initial, knowing what your purpose is, knowing who you want to serve, knowing what your goals are, they're definitely going to be those guiding points to help our young girls, our young ladies to move forward in that direction.
Okay. I almost want to say, does it matter? Would that be true for any profession that they're seeking to engage? I'm going to ask another question instead, because I'm trying not to step off into it too early, right? But would that be sort of also true for any field of endeavor that you might want to engage?
Absolutely.
Okay. I'm going to ask Miss Canary. Canary. All too often, we measure success by those high-profile jobs, right? Vice President Kamala Harris, a Stacey Abrams who could pull a whole state together, right? Those who are doctors, lawyers. I know that there was a few years ago, there was a conversation with students. And the conversation and the bulk of the conversation was geared towards being doctors and lawyers and the high profile kind of professions. I guess the high profile, right? Miss Canary, there was one young lady in the group who
yes.
raised her hand and simply said, "And can you all hear me? Okay." Who simply said, "You know what? I want to be a teacher. I want to be a teacher, and I just want to be a good teacher." What would you say when the focus so often is on those high-profile kinds of positions and things? What would you say to that young woman who says, "I want to be a teacher. I see nothing wrong with being a teacher. I just want to be a good teacher." What would you say to her? Ms. Gallion.
Well, what I would say to her, follow your passion. We all have a talent. I feel that we all have a God-given talent that God has given all of us. My talent may not be to be a doctor, so I may be looking at, okay, the status. I may be looking at a way of making a lot of money, but I feel that all of us have a passion here in the earth. If we take that God-given passion that God has given us, then we produce. You know, because some jobs, just like a teacher, that's very rewarding. You have a lot of women that are in those fields, and according to data, a lot of the fields such as being a teacher and other fields where women are in, they are paid less. It's a very rewarding career. And so I believe that your talent is something that God has given you in order for you to produce in the earth. We go and look back in the word and we think about the parable of the sword. So if God has given you a talent and you hide it in the earth or you doesn't produce from your talent, then that wastes. And so we all have those talents and abilities, but it's what's rewarding to a person. You know, what I would consider rewarding was something that I want to do and I have a passion for. So it depends on what motivates the person. And so their drive should motivate them to pursue certain careers, and people know their abilities and their gifts, so that's a rewarding career as well.
Okay, so then would it be safe? And
so
maybe
I would say pursue your...
You say that one more time, you froze on us. Say that one more time, you froze on us.
Okay, I would say to her, pursue your dreams.
Pursue your dreams. Okay, and so that's if it's a teacher, because you also have women in various fields, right? Going into fields that were not typically filled with women. Women who are becoming supervisors in construction work, right? So would that be fair? And just a quick, I guess I'm, I don't know if I'm looking for nodding of the head for agreement or what, but is it fair to say that it doesn't matter if you're Kamala Harris, the Vice President of the United States, a teacher in a classroom, or a woman who is a manager of a construction project? Wherever you fit in the scheme of things, you have value, and as a black girl, you rock. Is that pretty fair? Okay, I'm going to ask. Canary, that you're often in the office, and you get out, but you don't have the kind of engagement with students that perhaps Danielle has. So, Miss Danielle McGhee, I'm going to ask you a question, and I don't know. I'm not trying to put you on the spot, but I'm going to ask you a question. And the question is, have you seen Black Girl Magic on the Huston-Tillotson University campus?
Yes.
Oh, I like how you said that. Okay.
Pre-pandemic, yes.
Okay.
Yes, definitely see it every day. Saw it every day.
Can you just talk a little bit about that, what that looks like on the Huston campus?
I mean, I see how, you know, just from, you know, I have windows in my office, so being able to see how students move in the library from, you know, when they're trying to get their work done, they're super focused, seeing them collaborate, you know, with their peers, and also just from the fashion sense, you know, clothes, like what they like to wear, just the creativity, the hair. You know, you see students every day, and the hair is different. We're just so versatile in how we dress, how we look, but also, you know, in terms of just how smart our girls are. I just see them in here all the time. They're coming to ask me questions about, you know, how they should accomplish their tasks or how they should navigate with certain, you know, problems or things they're interested in on campus. And so I see a lot of that momentum and that motivation and that intellect, you know, when our students were on site. And so, but even online, just engaging with our students on social media, you know, just seeing what they're doing in their free time. Our girls rock.
All right. I like that. Yay! See, Black Girls Rock. Like that. It is that time, and I always get to this point, and I have to ask, could you succinctly give some advice to our students on the campus, but specifically to our young women on the HC campus? And if you could do it quickly for me, I would appreciate it.
Okay, so my advice would be to pursue your passion into break glass ceilings. We have a lot of hidden figures, and some you may be a hidden figure, but what you do has purpose in life, and so pursue it. Serve others in what you do, and that's rewarding in all different ways. So be a go-getter. Make things happen. So that's what I would give to them.
Okay, you're hidden figure. It's okay, but make it happen. I like that. How about Danielle? Any words of wisdom? Succinctly. Come on, help.
Okay. I would say to, in terms of encouragement, to listen to your inner voice and be honest with yourself about what your dreams are, what your desires are, and with being true, you know, to who you are, and just to pay attention to your intuition, because that will take you far.
I love that, being true to who you are. Thank you so much, ladies. I appreciate you. I applaud you and what you do on the campus. You are very special. I always enjoy being in those spaces and places where we're praying, Canary, and Danielle. This has been a journey, and it's not over, it's still a journey, but thank you for your support and your prodding and pushing. So praise God for you, appreciate you, and we'll be seeing you on campus, and we'll be talking soon. All right? All right. I want to give some praise for Ms. McGhee and Miss Gallion. I'm going to share now. It's time for the spoken word. And as we prepare for that, as usual, we play a selection. I'm going to play Kirk Franklin, My Life, My Love, My All. And after that, the next voice you will hear is that of Minister Stinson.
Just want to tell you thank you just for being patient with me, just for giving me another chance. You've always been there for me. You were the father that I never knew. I just want to say.
Several different challenges, some civil unrest, some things that just
has happened and that we've experienced because we live in this world, in this society. And so I want to just encourage us today. I want to encourage us because God is truly a good God. So I've entitled this message, Oh, What Peace We Often Forfeit. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. When we think of the concept of peace, many of us might think that peace is the absence of war or a treaty between warring nations, groups, to end hostilities and to abstain from further fighting. And this is true based on the definition of peace in the dictionary. The dictionary also states that it is a mutual harmony between people or groups. It also states that it is the normal freedom from civil commotion and violence of a community, a public order, and security. These are all very true statements, very true statements. But what I want to submit to you today is that even when there is a lack of peace in our nation, even when there is a lack of peace in our state and in our communities, you can still have the peace of God. That's important. We can still have the peace of God. Even when you're faced with challenging and discomforting times, even when we're faced with challenging and discomforting times, as we faced even a few weeks ago during the freezing temperatures, you can still have peace. Brothers and sisters, there is no doubt that something else is coming. We went through a freeze, you know, we've been through some different things, but there is still yet some things that we're going to have to face on this side of the earth. There's no doubt. Something is coming that will arouse emotions. Something is coming that will challenge your faith. You can still have the peace of God in the midst of all of those things, or in the midst of any of those situations. The peace of God is simply being confident in the fact that I am with him and he is with me. That's a biblical definition, that God is with me and I am with him. That he has me. I have him and he has me. The peace of God is simply that confident in trusting that. We have to believe and we have to remember and we have to believe and we have to trust. Embrace and entrust the scripture that declares the Lord saying that, lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. That is the scripture that you need to hold on to. That's a nugget that you need to hold on to. He says, lo, I am with you all. That means no matter what you go through in life, as low as you think you have gone, he says, I am always with you, even until the end of the world. Matthew chapter 11. I want to draw our attention to Matthew chapter 11. This is where our foundational text is going to come from. This is where we're going to just launch off into this teaching. Matthew 11, starting in verse 2, it says, Now when John had heard in the prison the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples and said unto him, Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? Jesus answered and said unto them, Go and show John again those things which you do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. The lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. Verse 6, And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. This is our foundational text this morning. And here we see that John the Baptist, he was in prison at this time. He was the one who was sent as the forerunner for Jesus. The one who proclaimed repentance for the kingdom of heaven was at hand. And he baptized those that believed. But here we see that he was in prison for courageously and publicly speaking out, doing the right thing, and proclaiming the standard of God. He could have kept his mouth closed. So at a time, it's not always convenient. It's not always easy to proclaim and to uphold the standard of God when things around you are contrary to that. But he decided that he was not going to be silent. he was going to proclaim the truth. He could have kept his mouth closed. He could have attended a wedding. So he was talking about the adultery affairs of the two that were getting married. And that's why he was thrown in prison. He could have kept his mouth closed. He could have attended the wedding. He could have given them a gift. He could have congratulated them all while knowing the standard. But he did not. We must speak up and uphold the standard of God if we profess to follow him as Christians, as believers. God does not leave room for compromise of his word and a compromise of his standard. To make matters worse, those that ultimately knew the law, the Jewish leaders, they could have stood up for him, but they did nothing and they said nothing, which probably made John the Baptist feel alone, as if he was the only one going through persecution, the only one going through something. Hold on to that. He might have felt like he was the only one going through. We must do what is righteous, even when it appears that we are doing it alone. Even in prison, John knew of the mighty works of Jesus, and he was receiving partial reports of his ministry from his disciples, but he cannot see the total picture. Why? Because he was behind bars, and he couldn't see what was going on around him. Sometimes the circumstances in our lives, sometimes the events in our lives, they are going all around us, and it hinders our ability to see and to focus on what God is doing. It hinders the ability to stay focused on the truth of the word of God. God's word is true. If he said it, I believe it. I trust it, and I have confidence in it. He had become discouraged. That's why he said, are you the one, or should I be looking for somebody else? He had become discouraged as he sat in prison, not being able to witness the ministry of Jesus for himself. Perhaps he had become disappointed that Jesus had not come to rescue him. After all, he was making a way for him. Surely if this was the coming king, he thought, he had preached about, he would have not allowed him to be in prison for the sake of ministry, for the sake of standing for righteousness. If you ever doubt, but I'm here to tell you though, that if you ever doubt that God is continuously at work even when you can't trace him, if you are ever discouraged in sorrow and grief because it appears that the unrighteous are winning, if you are ever discouraged in sorrow and grief when it appears that evil is prevailing, if you are ever discouraged because it appears that the Lord is taking too long to fulfill his promises, look to him, the author and the finisher of your faith, recognizing that feelings and emotions are very real. I recognize that feelings and emotions are very, very real. And they can tend to overtake or consume a person, even to the point of not being able to function in a healthy mental state. It is important to seek help at that time. It's important that you be able to talk through those challenges with professionals when necessary. I acknowledge the fact that we need to seek professional help. No doubt about it. God is a provider. He's provided that way. He's provided that opportunity. He's provided that avenue. But as believers and as Christians, we also must recognize our spiritual blessings that we can draw from. Our spiritual blessings. Indeed, Jesus is the counselor. And he is a God of peace. He is a God of peace. He wants us to have a sound mind. He wants us to be okay. He wants us to be at peace, even when things around us are at war, at bay. Even when we have those challenges, he wants us to be at peace. Take your feelings and your thoughts to the Lord in prayer. Also, as you're seeking, I'm not saying don't seek. You seek that professional help. If you need it, you seek that help because you do need it. But also remember that you can draw freely from the wells of salvation. You can draw freely from the wells of God's grace. And one thing that he has given us is the opportunity to approach his throne boldly. He says, boldly approach the throne of grace, and there you may obtain mercy. There you will be able to get the help that you need in the times that you need. What Jesus did not do. So what he did do was that he sent his word. He didn't go on his own. He didn't go to try to save John. He didn't do any of that. But he sent his word. He sent back. He told the disciples, go back and tell him again what you have witnessed, what you have seen, what you have heard. He says, basically, surely, let him know that I am at work. I'm still doing what I do. would always involve our things with certain things, because only God can handle certain things in our life. Vengeance is mine, said the Lord. Vengeance is mine, said the Lord. We do our part, and the things that we can do and we should do are a righteous standard when it comes to things that are around us, but that we cannot take the place of God. Let him be God, and let him do what he's going to do. So Jesus sent a message of comfort back to John. Jesus asked them to show John again what they had witnessed of his ministry. He was reassuring John that he was fulfilling the Father's will. He was assuring John that his labor was not in vain. Listen, your labor is not in vain. He was assuring John that his temporary situations for righteousness' sake was not in vain. He was assuring John that the word of God was coming to pass, even though he could not physically see him. The truth of the word declares that God is not slack in his promises, as we might think. He is working even when we cannot trace him. So the message today, my brothers and my sisters, is to hold on to God's unchanged. No, you don't hold on. Let him hold on to your hand. See, if you hold on to his hand, you might let go. But God is a God, and he will not fail. But we have to stay with him. We have to trust in him. We have to continue to believe in him. We have to love him with all of our hearts, our minds, our soul, and our strength. God is there for you, even in the midst. Again, it may look like things are prevailing unrighteously and the evil is prevailing. But understand this. Understand this. That God is a God. He is God, and he is God alone. And only he can do what he can do. We cannot take his place. We can do our part. We do our part, but we cannot take his place. But even in the midst of all of those things, even in the midst when you feel like that you can, there's just no help, even when you feel like and it seems that there's just no hope, understand that there is hope in this world, and that's found only in Christ Jesus. When you can't do, when you don't have the strength to do, when you don't have the capacity to do, when you can't do for yourself, you have a God, if you've accepted him, you have a God who fights for you. You have a God who fights for you. But more importantly, he is there for you. Brothers and sisters, do not lean to your own understanding, but all of your ways acknowledge him. He will direct you. He will guide you. Take your thoughts, take your feelings, take them to the Lord in prayer. And leave them there and trust him to be the God that he says he is, that his word declares. And I challenge you to get into his word. We've been in all this time, all of this, the stay home things of us lifted now into the state of Texas. But all of this time, and you still have the opportunity to be at home, get into his word. Trust him. Trust him. Tune in. If you don't have churches that are live streaming, tune in. Tune in somewhere. If you have churches that are meeting, go, because that will continue to strengthen you. From the word is where we draw our strength. And when we trust and believe and we obey, that is when we will see the manifestation of the word of God in our lives. Be blessed, my family. Be blessed. And have a good day.
Amen, amen. Minister Shakitha Stinson, thank you for that very strong word, Minister Stinson. Indeed, it's a word that touches our heart. What peace. And we understand that there are challenges in life, but with those challenges that come, when you walk with Jesus, you can find that place of peace. If you have a relationship with God, you understand that, and you know how to find that peace. If you do not have a relationship with Christ Jesus, with God through Christ Jesus, then I invite you to get connected and start that journey with God right now. For those who, if you're honest with yourselves, do not have a relationship with Christ, we invite you to pray this prayer with me right now. Gracious God in heaven, I come right now acknowledging that I am a sinner. I ask, gracious God, that you would come into my life, that you would forgive me of my sins, that you would be, dear God, my Lord and my Savior. I thank you, gracious God, for forgiveness. I thank you for salvation. Now grow me by your grace through your mercy. In the name of Jesus. Gracious God, for all who have prayed this prayer, we ask that you would give them the assurance that they belong to you, you belong to them, and nothing and no one can snatch them from you. We ask, gracious God, that they would now begin the growth process. We ask, gracious God, that you would move in their lives, that you would allow them to experience life in a brand new way, and also, gracious God, that they might experience as they journey through life in the midst of all of the challenges that they may confront, that they might discover and experience your peace. Move, gracious God, as only you can, and always through the power of your Holy Spirit, in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Amen and praise God. We want to thank our guest today, Miss Danielle McGhee, and also Miss Canary Gallion. And we also want to thank Minister Stinson for sharing with us today. Indeed, they have blessed our hearts. And as we prepare to leave this place, I want to remind all of our friends and family to remember the Huston-Tillotson University COVID-19 Support Fund. God is blessing and showering down blessings on the Huston-Tillotson University, but we still need your support. Open your minds, open your wallets, and please open your pocketbooks and give to Huston-Tillotson University through the Huston-Tillotson COVID-19 Support Fund found on the Huston-Tillotson website. I want to also say to our students who are still engaging in exams, we have been praying for you. I have been praying for you. As we end this week and begin spring break, lots of things going on, cities are opening up, folk are going to the beach. I encourage you to be wise, to act with wisdom, and to stay safe. Protect yourself and protect your loved ones. As we engage in spring break, have fun, but be safe. Pray that we will see you again next week. Pray that something today has touched your heart, has created a stirring in your very soul, and that draws you closer to Christ. Praise God for you. Look for you. Same time next week, same place. Until then, be blessed.